Downtown Rotary. It's Thursday. It's about 12:15, and I'm going to change it up like I did last week a little bit, because we have some things to award. Last week we handed out some Paul Harris fellowships, and we're going to do the same today, because we have about 50 of them to do. Not today. Don't worry. But a number of you have shown up, and I'm going to call you if you please come up. Let's see, first of all, David Brown, John Cooper, Dana Lassen, Connie Bailey, Kara Ireland, Kurt Laverton, George Brown, and Jordan Mattson. Thank you, John. Dana, thank you very much. Connie Bailey. In alphabetical order, like I was hoping. Karen Ireland. This is number two, if I remember. My record, correct? And George Brown. I'm just going to mention that George, this is his sixth. I hope you get the name. Maybe you did get your sixth. He says he has seven. So fantastic. George, would you come right up here, please?
No, he's in trouble.
So, Jordan gets a little something extra for his Paul Harris Scholar Fellowship because somebody told me it was his birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jordan. Happy birthday.
Okay. Teresa. I think Teresa's going to be doing the music that I see here. Yes!
It's only a couple of us in here.
Okay. So, thank you.
Alright, hi everybody. It's been a minute. How's everybody doing? I was asked to do music today, and Charlie's mad at me, but I went ahead and picked a video. So I'm glad you're all still seated because I was going to ask you to sit back down. Gearing up for Martin Luther King Jr. Day on Monday, it's a song from the movie Selma. And it's called Glory. It's by John Legend. I can't talk. John Legend and Common. So sit back, enjoy your lunch, and enjoy the music.
Glory come, it will be out, it will be out. Oh, one day, when the war is won, we will be strong, we will be strong. Oh, glory, 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 oh, glory, glory.
Hands to the heavens, no man, no weapon. Formed against death, glory is destined. Everyday women and men become legends. Says they go against our skin, become blessings. The movement is a rhythm to us. Freedom is like religion to us. Justice is juxtaposition in us. Justice for all, just ain't specific enough. One son died, the spirit is revisiting us. True and living, living in us. Resistance is us. That's why Rosa sat on the bus. That's why we walk through Ferguson with our hands up. When it go down, we women and men up. They say stay down, and we stand up. Shots be on the ground. The camera panned up. King pointed to the mountaintop, and we ran up.
One day, when the glory comes, you'll be out. You'll be out. Oh, glory, glory, glory. Now the war is not over, victory is won, the fight on. Anyway, it's all done. Cry glory, oh glory, oh.
Summer's now for every man, woman, and child. Even Jesus got his crown in front of a crowd. They march with the torch, we gon' run with it now. Never look back, we done gone hundreds of miles. From dark roads, hero, to become a hero. Facing the league of justice, his power was the people. Enemy is lethal, a king became regal. Saw the face of Jim Crow under a bald ego. No one can win the war individually. And take the wisdom of the elders and young people's energy. Welcome to the story we call victory. The coming of the Lord, my eyes have seen the glory.
One day, when the glory comes, you'll be out.
Thank you, Teresa. That was a beautiful tribute. Beautiful. All right, our invocation today is given by Deanna and Tony.
So today's program title is Simon and Garfunkel, a touring perspective. Paul Simon and Art Garfunkel, two of my favorite artists, have written and performed a number of songs considered classics. Can you imagine your life without music? It's almost impossible. Whether you were driving in the car, listening to Muzak at a doctor's office or in an elevator, or if we ask Siri or Alexa to play something, we are constantly surrounded by music. Breakups, makeups, parties, spending time with friends, singing along with our kids, enjoying musical theater, the symphony, Christmas carols, hymns, or a good gospel song. Music stamps nearly every aspect of our life. Most of us have songs that accent different phases of our life. Melodies that instantly bring us back to specific moments or memories when we hear them years later. Music touches us emotionally much more than words alone. So, lucky for you, I'm not going to sing, but please join me as I give thanks for music. Lord, thank you for the gift of music and for those with talent for writing the lyrics and tunes that touch our souls. Thank you also for those with voices that move us. Bless our time together today, and may we find common joy in music. Amen.
Thank you, Leanne. Well, first of all, I would like to welcome any guests who have joined us today. If you are a guest, would you mind standing so that we can see you and acknowledge you and greet you? Amen. Thank you for joining us today. I think it's going to be a great program. I'm looking forward to it. I like music. All right. Monday, let's see, January 16th. Make sure I'm in the right. So I think right now going on is a. This is a timeline of the MLK Junior events, and some of them I think are going on right now. The 20th annual Lee Pageant. A food drive. You can drop food off at Davis or Eisenhower. We've got some bins out in front of the main entrance, the main office. So we still participate in that. I'm just going to give a couple highlights. There's a basketball tournament that may need volunteers to referee or to coach, and some sponsors are needed to sponsor the players. Eric, do you know what that sponsor cost is? $11 something like that?
$7 a player.
$7 a player. Thank you, Anthony. So, $7 a player. Jump in.
Plus
four for one.
$7 entry fee. $11 total.
Okay, $11 total. Oh, so you get more value. Yeah.
You gotta eat too.
Gotta feed those athletes. The MLK commemoration service at Greater Faith Baptist Church will be on the 15th. That's 3 p.m. on 816 South 16th Street. And then on the 16th is the MLK Peace Walk, and that will start from 5th Avenue and Lincoln. You can park, I understand, in the Celerity parking lot. Is Mina here to corroborate that? Okay. Anyway, park there. So, hope you'll join. Rotary has a banner that is going to carry through the walk, and it's supposed to be about 40 degrees, no rain. So, please think about joining. And you know, the more people we have participating, the greater the impact. So, hope to see you there. And on the back of your tutor, if it came out last week, there are more items that pertain to. Okay. Aaron Black, President Elect.
Good afternoon, President Rick and Rotarians. What a privilege to be serving as President Elect, and I'm often wondering how does time fly by so quickly. I'm realizing 6 months now. A year ago is when I found out, and time has flown by. One of the distinct privileges that I have in being president-elect is serving as the nominating committee chair, and I was able to ask six of our fellow Rotarians to work with me to identify three Rotarians to step onto the Rotary Board for a three-year term. So I want to first thank the nominating committee. So if you just stand up real quick, it's Sony Alexander, Kelly Gasling, Brad Hansen, Brad Kessinger, Sonia Rodriguez True, and Eric Silvers. Yes, I had two Brads, so they've identified themselves as Brad 1 and Brad 2. So ask them who's first and who's second. So we decided on three very strong leaders in our club, and I'd like for them to stand. Ryan Anderson, Rich Austin, who's not here today from Seattle, with his wife, and Rebecca Pennell. So my first official duty here is that I am seeking a motion and a second.
So moved. Second.
Okay, great. And now I need all of you to participate with all of you in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, you guys are official. Congratulations. Thank you.
As we look forward to Aaron's year, it has come to the attention of us who have been on the board and the president position that about every 5 years we are trying to reassess our Rotary Club. And part of that is to do a survey. A survey has been put together. It will go out probably next week sometime. And we really hope that you will take the time to fill it out. There are some boxes that allow comments, other than just a yes or no answer, but just to give the board some feedback on how you think about your Rotary experience. And we always want to improve on it whenever it's possible, so again, You have the opportunity to make some suggestions, maybe some criticisms, and we'd like to hear them. The survey goes out next week. Watch for it. Please take some time to fill it out. So we do have a little bit of time, and some of you are familiar with my one-minute Rotary interview, but I'm going to do something a little different than suggested to me by Kelly Connaughton. I'm going to ask each of you at the table to, well, pick somebody next to you and share a Rotary story with that person. Maybe it's, how come you joined Rotary? What was there an experience in Rotary that you kind of went, wow, that's pretty cool? Geez, do we encourage the others? You know, like, whoa, that was horrible. trying to be uplifting in this case, but I think all of us have some kind of a Rotary story. And I'd like you to take 3 or 4 minutes, turn to the person next to you, and see if that person has a story, and vice versa. So, good luck.
Like meet. But I'm really actually, now that I go by there, I think, I have to do this. This is so cool. So I really enjoyed the result. The process was a lot. I went down there by myself one night, waiting in the heat by myself because I needed one last thing. But I thought, oh boy, it's really, really hot. And, that was fun to do. Glad I did it.
All right, by the sound of the decibel level of conversation, I think people were pretty active in their stories, maybe. I'm just going to ask if anybody would like to volunteer a story that was told. Brad, he's going to talk about Jordan?
No.
Brad Hanson, stand up if you're going to speak.
I've got a Harry Hellison story.
Oh, Harry Hellison story, all right.
Harry Hellison told us that the person who got him into robbery is still alive today.
Jesus walked. Dick Marble.
Dick Marble, yes. And Dick Marble's son is here as well. Ken Marble. Hello, Ken. Anybody else? Well, two hands were raised there. You're going to have to fight over it.
My robbery story is my motor club that I meet with every month. Love our club.
All right. You're not the only one. No. Was there one? Yes. Yeah.
Our robbery story was we have a non-Rotarian guest here today, and so we all shared with her the reasons why she should get into it.
Excellent. Excellent. All right, I have a story I'd like to share. It has to do with serving on the Special Recognition Unsung Hero Committee, where we have the opportunity to select people from our community who have out of sight but do great things. I went to the funeral of a client of mine, and while I was there, I saw in attendance a classmate of mine from high school, and someone went also with him. It turns out that the two of them, plus a deceased client, were all Vietnam vets. And as I listened to the story about my client and his life and what he'd done recently prior to passing away, I thought, wow, that's pretty cool. And then these two guys next to me were part of that effort. And that was to set up a veterans food bank. Apparently there was not one available in Yakima, and they took it upon themselves to fund it, stock it, open it up, run it, restock it, raise money. And once I heard that, I thought, wow, that's pretty cool. And I think they deserve to have some recognition. So had the pleasure of presenting the award to the two surviving members and also the spouse of the deceased. And she was moved by the honor and just gave me chills. And I thought, wow, this is pretty cool. Yeah. All right, that's my story. Is the Sergeant of Arms at attention?
Yes.
No. Okay, Mike Johnson?
Yep.
And
all questions.
Yep. Well, good day there, Downtown Rotary. It's time we take your dough, but I promise you will learn some things about Simon and Garfunkel you probably didn't know. Lords and ladies, oust your wallets, get those greenbacks set to fly, for these stories about friends who met in grade school, their surprising, but I promise they're all true. I won't lie, I won't lie, 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 and I'll tell you why. Because the 408 test says Rotarians do not lie. Okay, you know that Simon, thank you. You know that Simon and Garfunkel, but it's time to play Simon or Garfunkel, okay? And I want a raucous concert-going crowd here. When you think it's Simon, you can yell out Simon. When you think it's Garfunkel, you can yell out Simon, yell out Garfunkel. So this is fascinating. One of them was born in Newark to a Hungarian Jewish family. The other was born in Queens to a Romanian Jewish family. And what I want to know is, which one of them was born in Newark to the Hungarian Jewish family? Don't pay attention to that little arrow. It just is meant to, it was the way PowerPoint gave it to me, all right? So it was a Simon or Garfunkel. Let me hear it. Was it Simon or Garfunkel? Come on, tell me. Was it Simon or Garfunkel? It was Paul Simon. Paul Simon was born in Newark, and then his family moved to Queens when he was a kid, and in sixth grade at PS 164, it's where he met Art Garfunkel, and they formed a little band right then and there, and off they went. So if you thought that Paul Simon was actually born in Queens, then you should pay some money, equivalent to a concert ticket to see Simon and Garfunkel. Okay. Next one. One of them studied math education at Columbia University. One of them studied law at Brooklyn Law School. Yes. Which one studied law at Brooklyn Law School? Was it Simon or was it Garfunkel? Which one? Simon, I'm hearing Simon. Am I hearing Garfunkel?
Garfunkel.
It was Paul Simon. Paul Simon actually did a semester of law at Brooklyn Law School. Art Garfunkel completed his master's degree, by the way, in math education. I guess he was hedging his bets. If the music thing didn't work, he was going to be a teacher or something like that. And so math and music are related. So there you go. Okay, ready for the next one? One of them was the neighbor of Saturday Night Live founder. One of them is the cousin of the Backstreet Boys founder. Lou Pearlman, that's right. Which one? Which one is the cousin of Lou Pearlman, the Backstreet Boys founder? Was it Simon or Garfunkel? Which one was it? Come on, let me hear you. Was it Simon? Was it Garfunkel? Who was it? Art Garfunkel's cousin is Lou Pearlman. Who, when he saw how much money could be made in the 90s with a boy band, he did a $3 million nationwide talent search and recruited all five members of the Backstreet Boys and created that band from scratch. And then the success of that had Pearlman take over NSYNC, which, by the way, launched Justin Timberlake's career. And so Lou Pearlman, by the way, died in federal custody in 2016, and he was convicted in 2008 of a gigantic Ponzi scheme. So apparently making money off the Backstreet Boys wasn't enough. Okay, here's an interesting one. Which one of these two read lessons aloud to his blind college roommate, who then in gratitude gave him $500 so the two of them could go record the demo of Sound of Silence? Isn't that amazing? Was it Simon or Garfunkel? Which one of them ran for lessons aloud to his blind college roommate? Was it Simon or Garfunkel? It was Art Garfunkel. Yes, amazing. So Art Garfunkel's kindness to his college roommate produced the chance to record the demo of The Sound of Silence. So a little kindness goes a long way. It really does. It really does. Okay, last one. Here's your last chance. While an undergrad, this guy was a member of his college tennis, skiing, fencing, and bowling teams, and a member of an all-male vocal group. That's right. Incredibly industrious during his undergrad. Which one was it? Was it Simon or was it Garfunkel? Was it Simon or Garfunkel? If you thought it was Paul Simon, you're wrong. Apparently, when Garfunkel wasn't reading lessons out loud to his blind college roommate, he's also doing all that stuff. Whoa! Crazy! That's amazing. Absolutely amazing. Thank you for playing Simon or Garfunkel. I think we just created a new Rotary tradition. I mentioned we should do Simon or Garfunkel. We've made history this morning, or this afternoon, but some history was also made. It's my joy to announce to you that some history was also made at 12:26 a.m. on December 31st. A 6-pound, 4-ounce little Eric Silvers III was born. So, picture. So if you think that if you think babies are cute, you need to pay some money. Alright? I think babies are cute, and I'm paying some money. Alright. Well, thank you for playing Simon or Garfunkel. I'm not sure there was any enthusiasm there. Great job, Mike. Thank you. Okay, today we have a couple of speakers who will be joining us. I think we've been primed for them. And Charlie Rotten will introduce them on their program.
Thank you, President Rick, and for fellow Rotarians, I'm thrilled to welcome to the stage Dean Elliott and Ralph Schmidtke. Hello. Grab your mics on, which is at the bottom, right in the middle there. For those who don't know, we have had the privilege of having the company in town this past week because this has been another opportunity where working with the producers, we have had a pre-tour tech in the Capitol Theater, always making sure that the community knows that the investment they have made in the Capitol Theater and building the production center and the Forestry Theater, all the great advances we have in the space, provide us the opportunities where the companies will actually choose Yakima as the place to come in, build the show, put everything together, rehearse. Rather than some of the other touring companies which come in and they arrive the night before, they load in early in the morning and they're gone within 2 days. So we've had the great privilege of having them with us all week, and they've had the chance to get to our coffee shops and to our hotels and our restaurants and the like. So it is great to have you guys with you, and thank you for choosing Yakima.
Thank you for having us.
I'm going to have them individually tell a little bit more of the story, but I'll prime them with a few things. I'm going to ask them a few questions, but it's really going to be upon you to ask questions. What I will share is that you were only helped this much if you saw the show last night in that Sergeant of Arms presentation. Because I would have bet Mike that we really did find things were truly obscure and not necessarily addressed during the show. But the guys have had one particular experience that I did want them to share, because they are clear that Yakima is the happiest place in the world. As they were exiting the backstage last night, they had a particular experience, a particular aroma that was permeating, and they were convinced it was something else, not realizing that Chief Hops is just down the road in the hospital. They knew that marijuana was legal in Washington, they just didn't know that everyone was partaking. Getting out of the backstage last night, it was quite the smell. It was quite the potent aroma.
I loved it.
He was where? So Ralph should be. Ralph is actually on the trio of producers, trio of organizations that have pulled this together. Ralph is our Canadian, eh? Now, he won't get any attention because, as you'll hear very quickly, Dean Elliott is from England.
G'day.
So we know the Americans and the British accent always wins over, so we'll give them equal time. Now, Ralph, you have been in the industry for over 16 years in the recording side.
Yes.
And then moving into producing from there. You want to tell us a little bit more?
Well, in 1986, I was hired as a sales rep for EMI Music in Vancouver, British Columbia, and bounced around Western Canada for 16 and a half years and ended my career as director of sales and marketing for Western Canada. And back then, it was right around Napster starting to take hold in the marketplace, and we saw our recorded music sales plummet very quickly, and I got a brown envelope in April of 2003, and which it was, you know, was inevitable.
The equivalent of a pink slip, I believe, in the United States.
Yeah, well, it's better than a pink one. There was more than that in the envelope, so I was quite happy the way it all worked out. And at that time, we were living in Vancouver, and my family wanted to move back to Calgary because I bounced around quite a bit over the years. And So we did, and I happened to meet somebody that I knew from the promoting business who encouraged me to come and work with them on the live side. So I segued over to the live side in 2003, and here I am today. It's been, I got to tell you, I've been extremely fortunate in my life doing what I do for the number of years that I've been able to, because I love it. Every day, of course, we all have bad days. I don't care who you are and what you do, but we were talking about how do you go a day without music. I listen to music every day, almost all day, and my partner has to close her office door because she doesn't often like what I'm listening to, because we both, have home offices. But I've been, producing with another company since that period, 2003. And the big show for us then was Rain, a tribute to the Beatles. And then I left that company and met Dean Elliott in the fall of 2016, and saw himself perform as Paul Simon in a dinner theater in Edmonton, Alberta. And I saw the same kind of reaction from the fans. They were happy, they were sad, they were dancing, they were hugging, getting emotional. And so I figured, well, this is kind of like Rain in its own way. So fast forward to where we are today. We've been co-producing this in North America for 6 years, our sixth year. We took some time off during COVID, it's been amazing. The show is just keeps on trucking, and we're thankful for that. And thank you who bought tickets to come out and see it. It really does benefit the community on a micro level. We were looking for a place to eat last night. Most restaurants were packed. We see that in market after market that we go to, and there have been studies that, when a Broadway series or a show comes to town, the spin-off effect in the local community is immense. So whoever can support the arts, I tip my hat to you.
And we're very clear, in this crowd today we have three groups of people. We have those who saw the show last night, we have those who already have their tickets for tonight, and those who still have to get on their phone to buy their tickets for tonight. Now, want to be clear, you actually came to this whole industry speaking from the performance side, Dean, am I correct?
Yeah, I was a performer for a long time.
And specifically Bunny.
Yeah, it's weird turning up in Yakima, because I'm the face of Buddy, the picture, the guy doing, that's me on the guitar, in the poster, on your wall. So I was like, that's weird. I'm like, I'm So I did Buddy in the West End for like 3 years? 3 years, and then worldwide. That was great. Like, I love. Yeah, music is great, right? It's awesome. And I'm very fortunate to have been a performer of music. I'm a musical director and ex-performer. So I've been on the other side of the fence, and it was amazing. I got to tour world with it. Especially Buddy, we did North America, we did all over Asia, Europe, and then the West End. We sat in London for a long time. And it was brilliant. I'll be honest, like, it took a massive toll. I have young children and a family and a wife, and it's a difficult life, yeah. Being on the road, like, as a touring musician. And it was difficult, and I think anyone who decides to continue to do that later in their sort of life, it gets harder. It's a young person's game, really. So I decided to turn to the dark side and become a producer. Which meant I could be at home, but I've been Yakima.
Well, you only get up for the special events.
Yeah, I come up for the special ones. I was in the West End, and I was in the backstage, and I was thinking about a show I wanted to put together. And I wanted it to be a bit like Buddy in the way that it was like a rock and roll biopic. I wanted it to be something I cared about, that I knew about, because I probably wouldn't have done a good job if I didn't know what I was talking about. about. And then I just sort of came to Simon & Garfunkel, and I was like, I've been a massive fan of Simon & Garfunkel my whole life. As a guitarist, I find Paul Simon's guitar playing difficult, so it was always a challenge to take on his music. And then I loved his songwriting. I genuinely think Paul Simon is, if not the best songwriter of all time, is definitely in my top two or three. And even his solo career away from Art Garfunkel, I find his songwriting like extraordinary. And we were talking last night, weren't we, about like revisiting him. He's so multi-layered. You have to work a bit hard. He's not so obvious as a songwriter. And the fact that he was like 16 with No Sound of Silence, which lyrically I think still holds so much weight and value today in 2023.
Yes.
Officially. Yeah, officially. Like, and it was written in 1964. It blows my mind that he could write songs that are so timeless. Anyway, so I decided to put together this show, Simon & Garfunkel Story. So it's a weird one actually, because I don't know if anyone here can, I've never been able to find someone who can answer this. I don't know an artist or a band whose final record was their most successful.
Yeah.
I don't know if anyone can wrap their brains and think of, I'm not talking about somebody who had one record or two records, but like had a career and their final record is by far their biggest. I mean, in the show, I won't spoil it for you, but we talk about Bridget Jones Awards, and it was the biggest selling album for 3 years in a row, and the house sold the Beatles was massive. So like, when you're trying to write a show, and you're trying to build to a crescendo, it's kind of hard, because like, even the Beatles, you'd probably argue that Sgt. Pepper's, that kind of era was there, they, you know. But with Simon & Garfunkel, it goes from a folk duo right to the biggest album, and then you lose them, right, and then they come back for a meeting concert. So he kind of wrote itself quite a lot, the show. I decided we'd tour in the UK. I thought we'd get a couple of weeks out of it. We've now been to over 50 countries. We've toured it all over the world. Just before the pandemic, we have four casts going out. We have one in West End, we have one internationally, two here in North America. But yeah, like, I was always looking for the right team to do it, because I knew it would do well here in North America. So I was really happy to find Ralph and, get to know him and love with him and that. And, between us, well, Ralph's expertise really, just took it to the next level, and so proud of what we managed to do with that, and so proud of our team that we cast, and it's been a joy.
And your American partner is?
Right Angle Entertainment, based out of Los Angeles. They actually invited me to go see the show in Edmonton, just because they really hadn't been in the musical tribute area.
Yeah.
And when I got up there, they were shoving more tables into a dinner theater than as quickly as they could. It was like the second largest grossing show.
So the guy
who's crazy,
the bloke who like runs it, to be made of mine, it was funny, he was like, that dinner theatre has been running since the 50s or 60s or something, it's been going forever. And he said, you know what, you have sold more tickets than any other show in this dinner theatre, apart from one. And I went, that's amazing. I'm kind of annoyed that we're not. What was number one? And he went, Buddy.
Well, I might have to accept that as well.
Yeah, so I guess so. I don't know.
If they're too bad. Any questions that we have from the crowd? Because Lord knows you all know me, I can talk forever. And then we'll come back over here.
What sort of permission do you have to get from Simon & Garfunkel to do the show that sings their songs and uses kind of their style?
So what's the permission required of the producers to tell the story of these two individuals who are living in Simon & Garfunkel?
Well, first, to answer your question, and then Dean can add to this, it just depends depends on the artist. We, around the world, there are a bunch of collection agencies that will, you have to pay, like in Canada, we pay SOCAN 3% of the net box office after taxes. And you have to report that. Well, I do. I live by the rules. I come from treat people the way you want to be treated. So we're always above board. There are promoters out there that may try to get around it, but we just don't want to mess with the artist's income, whether they need it or not. We do right by it. So in Canada, it's a 3% levy on the net, and we report it with the set list, because sometimes you get set lists that aren't written by the artist that's performing them, so they get those individual mechanical royalty rates. But in the U.S., we pay ASCAP or BMI, whoever administrates the works of those songs. You can take it a step further and then get grant rights, which we just secured for another show that we have in development. In the case of Rain, a tribute to the Beatles, we work directly with Sony Publishing to pay them directly from the box office percentage that they were owed based on negotiated rates. So you do have to pay. It depends too, because if you're just a straight concert or a straight tribute act, you typically can get away with just paying those normal rates, be it SOCAN, ASCAP, BMI. And in Europe, they have different rates. You know, I think Germany, they were shooting for 9%. I think they're at 6 now.
Yes.
You know, every territory is different in what they charge. And then, but you know, in the case of Paul Simon, he's well aware of what the show is and what Dean has written.
We think you may have come to see it. I think in the case of the Simon and Garfunkel story, we don't have grant rights for the show. We've applied with them, tried to get to the table and talk to Paul Simon. Because Paul Simon wrote all the songs, so he owns the rights for those songs as well. He sold them to Sony. But yeah, we tried to get them to the table. He doesn't want to, and he doesn't really want to grant any licenses to any Simon and Garfunkel material. And I don't know why. I think he's just still not got back together with Garfunkel. I think the two of them are not at the same table still, I think. And I think anything that he would sign and say, yeah, I'm going to give you the grand rights to do this, which would maybe be a public show of, actually, I want to revisit this world a bit. He's very happy for us to do the show and keep sending jets. More than happy with that. But I don't think he would want to come along and say, yes, I publicly associate myself with this material. Does that make sense?
And anytime there's an event in the theater that uses music with the touring companies, the producers are managing that themselves, so those agreements are managed to them. Anything else that's either a tribute band or anything else that we even play music, we have our own ASCAP BMI agreements that we send them quarterly checks as well, so that we're covered. Yeah, Kim Symphony Orchestra, they have to do the same thing, but they also have their own contract to manage theirs as well. So
I think also Paul Simon, and our Garfunkel are very aware of the show. They know what the content is. It's been very successful worldwide. We've got an inkling came to Westbury, England, with Paul Simon. There was something we heard afterwards that we're like, I think he kind of may have snuck in and see. Which is kind of wild. Imagine Paul Simon just sat in the room.
Yeah. Westbury is the closest venue to Queens, New York. And it's the only venue that I've been to where you always get people singing along the songs at these shows, but in Westbury, it was like a choir. It was unbelievable.
Yeah, and when we started the show, within 2 days we had a letter from his people. And I think he likes the show, I think he do a good job. I think he, but I just don't think he wants to come to the table to associate with him to do that here at Saturn.
I'll take one step further. I know we do a good job.
And those were the last I know as well. Welcome, you had a question as well.
You mentioned having a team here and also the advantages to the community by your presence. How many people did you bring with you, and what are some of the roles?
We probably have a team of around 16, 17 people. There's 10 in the touring show, but we also brought in a couple of extra because we rotate our Pauls and Arts. And we do have other band members that kind of say, well, you know what, because we started last night, and our tour doesn't end until almost the end of April. So a lot of people have other things they do in their lives. So some are recording artists. They're recording their own album. So we're flexible in allowing them to go come on for 4 weeks and then come back for 4 weeks. But to answer your question, we had like a three of Right Angles production people here just loading in the show. Because it's when you're teching in a venue, there's, and you have all this new gear that you've brought from suppliers, there's all those kinks to work out. You're running around for HDMI cables and looking for parts to, you know, you get a defective video projector, and next thing you were flying. So luckily, Dean and I don't have to deal with that kind of stuff anymore, but there are people on the ground that look after organizing these people, and there are nifty apps, but yeah, once people are starting to leave now that the show is up and running, but typically it'll be 10 on a bus. But then there's a support network of accounting people at Right Angles office. I look after the marketing as well. Dean's always, you know, on hand to make sure our talent is up to snuff. And so it takes a bunch of people to make this run the way it should be run.
Charlie?
Okay.
I saw it last night and loved it, so make sure you get in there tonight if you haven't already seen it. But I found myself a couple times almost mesmerized by what was happening on the screen in the back. And I wondered, has that artwork always been with the show for those 6 years, or does it change, and who created it, because it was beautiful?
Yeah, thanks, that's awesome. The video component, it was interesting actually, it goes back to this gentleman's question about getting the rights. So you probably know this, there's no pictures of Simon and Garfunkel in it. And that's an active choice. Well, two reasons, I think. One is we didn't want to sort of go down that route from like a legal perspective. And also, I think secondly, we thought it could be cleverer than that. I think it'd be quite easy to just put up pictures of Simon and Garfunkel. Oh, lovely, that's great. But actually, what I wanted to do, now, Simon and Garfunkel were very much of their time. They started as Simon and Garfunkel, they started in 1963 and they were done by 1970. So they were really a decade act. They obviously reformed later and did stuff, but their output materials in that decade, as we all know, was a very important decade worldwide, over here, across the pond in Europe, for a lot of, you know, social change, a lot of social political things, good and bad. And so we decided, if we're going to create a piece that is about an act that is set in one decade, potentially the most important decade for that, we should try and take people back in time, and we should try and create a time capsule on stage. Because another thing you'll notice, they don't move. Like, it's not a song and dance show where like Art Garfunkel does a tap dance, so there's a big, you know, like they don't move. They stand there and sing these songs, albeit beautifully, but they don't move. So the video component adds the historical social element to it, takes us back in time, makes us believe we're in the 60s, aided the lighting and the sound design. But also what it does, it adds the energy, it adds the drama, and there's parts in it, someone earlier said they cried a lot during the show, there's parts in it which are super moving, like you know, the old Friends segment for me with the pictures of the sounds of the old voices with the young faces, and it just like and then there's some footage from Vietnam with some children and just stuff, just like children with guns, and you're just like, oh my gosh, this is like so moving, and that is what theatre's about, isn't it? We can all just, you know, put on a gig with music, but we wanted to take people back in time and make them feel something. Thank you.
Mike, the mic right behind you.
Oh, me?
First of all, went to the show last night. Everyone should go. It was fabulous. My question to the talent, the Paul and the art nailed it.
Yes.
I mean, they were fabulous. I was blown away. How did you find them? I mean, are they people you already had kind of pegged? Did you do an open call? Have you worked with them for 10 years? Is it your brother-in-law? I don't
know. Yeah, we've been making 22-year-old boys perm their hair for 10 years now. That's true. We have both sides of the pond. We have a casting director in New York, and we have a casting director in London. And we've got good at it. Me and Ralph personally sit there for a week in New York in that room. That's one thing we are. Look, I just talked about video package and how beautiful and how it takes people on a journey, but actually, the most important part of the show is their voices. That's it. If that's rubbish, everyone's going to walk out, regardless if you've got a great video package. So we, Ralph and I, are really, really hot on making sure that those two boys can sing and perform those songs to that standard. We sort of hold ourselves to that standard. We have, that has to be right, otherwise there's no point. So we are pretty strong on the audition, aren't we?
I've learned a lot by sitting next to him in an audition room, and even though I don't play any instruments, my ears, I've been in this, listening to music for years from a label's perspective, and I can tell a bad tribute band from a good tribute band, I think, anyways. And sitting in an audition room with Dean for the last 6 years has taught me a ton. I could never be him. That we have different skill sets altogether.
I think it's with all English kids, right?
Yeah, he goes home saying some Canadian words, and I come home acting British. You know, it's like, but we do have a lot of fun, and we love being around each other. We decided amongst us in our partnership is we only want to work with people we can get along with and we like, and share the same kind of business principles that we all, you know, strive for. And so, yeah, when we audition, it's got to be on. You can't fake it, because it's about, Coca-Cola would never do that, nor do we.
Yeah, Ralph, you're going to be involved, you're general manager for the Our Planet Live Concert that we've got coming in October here, actually in February here. So you're involved in that. Collectively, you've done a variety of projects, everything from the British Invasion, the other things that... is there any of that new project stuff that you want to hint at might be possible for us to see down the line? Any secrets you might be able to... No one's going to tell.
Johnny Cash.
Okay, there's another part of the room I'm just not convinced or paying.
No, it is. It's a new show that we are doing, as I mentioned, with rights. We have obtained the rights from the estate of Johnny Cash. We have the rights secured from Sony Pictures to use his footage, and we have the rights from Sony Entertainment Publishing to use the songs that he has written. Now, there will probably be some songs in the show that will be written by other artists, because Sunday Morning Coming Down was not written by Johnny Cash. But we are, you're talking about when we're gonna go to Nashville, just the last 24 hours, when we go to Nashville to find this band and audition these singers.
Yeah, it'd be weird to do a show about Johnny Cash without the auditions in Nashville, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Not that you can't find them in London, but you need to.
Yeah.
So that rolls out this fall. And of course, the Our Planet thing that's a monster of a show. I'm not producing that. I'm putting it together for a producer from Amsterdam, and it's gonna have 18-piece orchestra augmented by pre-recorded tracks, so it'll feel like a 44-piece symphony orchestra. And we just announced that a guest narrator, William Shatner, is gonna be guest narrating with David Attenborough. So we're taking that in Farmington. Sorry we couldn't be here, Charlie, because it's, I don't think there's much in Farmington unless somebody here is from Farmington. But I'm looking forward to that one as well.
Well, our time is done. We wanna give a big round of applause to Matthew. I can't wait to go tonight. So are you in the audience, or do you hide out somewhere else? Are you backstage during the performance?
We'll be in the audience.
Okay. Judging and evaluating. Be looking for it. All right. Thank you. Thank you for taking the time to come and talk to us about Simon and Garfunkel. Before everybody leaves, I do need to ask, if you went to the auction, and you're a man, and you wore a coat there, did you wear the same coat when you left that you wore to the event? Because there is a person in our room here today who went to get his coat, and it wasn't there. So I believe it's a black, a dark black or wool coat. So if you went to the auction and you wore a coat, go home, look in your closet, try it on, look at the label. Ooh, geez, I didn't get that. And the rest of Missoula is the party you need to contact. So please do that for his sake. It's kind of cold out there.
All right.
Very quickly, next week's program is brought to us by Trevor Green, State of Yakima Schools. Yakima will be here. After that, Tom Tochterman, Animal Protection in Africa. And he knows what he's doing. That'll be a great program. Jesse Weinberry on the 2nd of February. I hope you're all here. That should be amazing. Jesse is the responsible party for pushing for the MLK holiday in the state of Washington. Make sure I'm right, Eric. So he's had an amazing career, continues to have an amazing life, so it'll be a great program. Don't forget the Rotary Survey. Come out next week, please. Take some time, think about it, answer honestly, give us some feedback as we go forward. All right, we are adjourned.